We have seen that we can compute the height and the arithmetic volume using the Ruf function. Now we go to another invariant, which are the essential and absolute minima. So let go to the usual setting. So we have KMK, a global field, and we have X over K projective and toric, and we have L bar, a metrized line bundle, a toric metrized quasi semi-positive quasi-algebraic line bundle. And we will assume that the line bundle L is ample. So we know that the height function, so we have now the height function that will go from x, k to to the real numbers, so x k bar. This, in the case of narrow field, this will satisfy Northcott property and is well behaved. Now we will define the absolute minimum of xl, or just absolute minimum, as the minimum possible value of the height. So this will be the infimum of the points x inside x of k bar of the height of p. So it's the minimal possible value that is obtained by the height. The problem with this invariant is that it may happen that some points have very low height just by special reasons. There is an isolated number of them, but if you take a general point, it will never approach this quantity. This is why one introduces a different minimum, which is the essential minimum, xl. This is the infimum of the set of all real numbers theta, such that the set of points inside x of k bar, such that the height of p is smaller or equal than theta, this is Stavisky dense. In x. Okay, so observe that here I am not bounding the degree. This means that it can be an infinite number of elements, even if the height is bounded. And then the idea is that you take a very high value of the height, then you will have a lot of points, an infinite number of points, and they will be dense in x. And now you start shrinking this number until the moment that you don't have enough points to fill all the space, and it stops to be Stavisky dense. More generally, we can define the successive minima that we will have the absolute minima, that is the mu zero, then this will be smaller or equal than mu one, smaller or equal than mu two, and so on, up to mu n. So always the dimension of x will be n, and this will be the essential minimum. And this is, so the mu I will be the infimum of the set of all real numbers theta, such that the set of points p in xk, such that the height of p is smaller or equal than theta. Now I take the Stavisky closure of this quantity and I look at the dimension of this quantity is bigger or equal than I. So the point is that I might have some subvarieties that are special and has a lot of points of low height. For instance, I have a curve and then I can have that the first minimum is very small. And you can see that if one applies this definition, mu zero, of course, if this is non-empty, the dimension will be bigger or equal than zero. So mu zero is the same as the absolute minimum, while mu n is the same as the essential minimum. For instance, let's assume that, let's go to an example. I take t1 and the naive height, the veil height, that is given by, I was defining this the first thing. So what is the absolute minimum in this case? Any idea? What was the absolute minimum? Eh?
One.
No, one, no. Remember that the veil height satisfies that the height is always bigger or equal than zero, and is zero if and only if we are looking at a root of one. Okay, so all root of unity have height zero. So what is the absolute minimum? Zero, because it's always bigger or equal than zero, and I know that some elements are zero. And what is the essential minimum? What do you think is essential minimum? So how many roots of one are there? Lots. Are infinite. So they are very skinny dense. So the essential minimum is also zero because the set of points with height zero is dense. Hence the absolute minimum is zero. Okay? So in this case it's easy. But let's now make the next easiest case. So I look now at P1 and I insert P1 inside P2. So one can do the same with P2, but let's, in this case, we'll put x inside P1 cross P1. That in affine coordinates will be x is sent to x1 minus x. Now I can take here the of 1 with a canonical metric, and this is I. We can look at L to be L bar to be I minus 1 of O1 with a canonical metric. Now, since this embedding is not even toric, so this will not even be a toric metric, and is clearly not the canonical metric, and the height associated to this line bundle was considered by Saguier, because the height, the Saguier height of a point x, since we are in a product situation, it turns out to be just the height of x plus the height of 1 minus x. So it's a very easy height that in some sense measures how far you are from 0 and 1 at the same time. Okay, it's a very nice, very simple height. It's just the next level of complexity. We are in P1, we are taking the canonical metric in this space and taking it back. Okay, the essential minimum, the absolute minimum, is still 0, because in P1 the height of 0 is 0 and the height of 1 is 0. Hence, in this Saguier height is the same. But what about the essential minimum? So the only thing is known, unless something has happened recently, is that this essential minimum is something between 0.48 and 0.5. 0.54. So there are methods to provide upper bounds, and there are methods to provide lower bounds, but I don't even know whether this quantity is computable, if there is an algorithm that gives you this quantity. So we know that it is in this interval, but we don't know how to compute. So,
do you know at least that it is algebraic or
No. Could be transcendental. I mean, since it is given as an infimum of these kind of things, one will bet that it is transcendental. But the point is that the only thing one gets is that, completely transcendental. The only thing that one gets is that one has upper bounds and one has lower bounds, but it's not clear whether this can give you an algorithm that computes this number, at least not to me. Okay, so it's a quite mysterious, statement. Which one? This one?
Yeah.
Or this one?
No, right.
Here. So what I'm saying is that The height of the point 0 in P1 is 0. And the height of the point 1 in P1 is also 0. So, if you take this definition of the Saguier height of the point 0, you will get that this is 0 plus 0 is 0. On the other hand, these two heights are bigger or equal than 0. So this one has to be bigger or equal than 0. So the absolute minimum has to be 0.
And for the other case?
Which other case? Here. But this is, well, but this is the vial height, the standard vial height that we studied before. And I remember that I told you this theorem that tells you that the height is, this vial height is always bigger or equal than 0. For instance, in the case, you can see this by looking at the definition I gave. So remember that if I have a point C in P1 of, or maybe just on the algebraic points, then I was taking the minimal polynomial, and then eta, I had this Galois orbit of xi, and then we had at the height of xi, so this polynomial was ad x to the d plus other terms. It was primitive and integral, and this was 1 over d, and then the log of ad, this is an integral number, so this logarithm is bigger than 0, plus the sum for all eta of log plus of the absolute value of eta. And again, log plus is something that is positive. So the height is always positive, and it was 0 if and only if the point is a root of 1. Okay? Now, so you have those. Then Zhang proved a very difficult theorem, let's say deep. So theorem by Zhang. That tells me the following thing. So with the hypothesis I have brought before, ampleness and so on, if I look at the product of all the successive minima, this is always smaller or equal than the height with respect to L bar of x divided by the degree of L of x, and this is always smaller or equal than n plus 1, the essential minimum. So there is always a lower bound of the essential minimum. That it can be, for instance, if we know that mu 0 is strictly smaller than this quantity, so in general, it implies that the absolute minimum and the essential minimum, there is a gap in between. And in fact, it was this theorem by Zhang that made Saguier to construct this example. Because this was, in some sense, one of the first examples when one can see that there is a gap between the absolute minimum and the essential minimum. Okay, and then theorem of Zhang tells you that there should be a gap, then Saguier found the first example of such gap.
Yes? We have an example in which they are equal.
Eh?
But we have an example.
Yeah, we have an example that they are equal, because in this case, in the vial height, it turns out that all the three terms are 0. So the point is that here I have a smaller or equal, this, and smaller or equal. So nobody tells you that the absolute minimum and the essential minimum can be the same, and all the successive minima can be the same. But what we know is that the absolute minima is smaller than this quantity, then there is a gap. Okay? And this was the example by Saguier. Okay, but as I have said many times, toric varieties are extremely easy. And we were able to compute the absolute minima and the essential minima in many, many cases. So you have the following theorem. With Philippon, Sombra, and myself. That tells the following thing, that remember that we have this true function. So this is a true function. Then the essential minimum is exactly the max for all x inside the polytop of theta of x, the absolute minimum is equal to the minimum for all x inside delta of this root function. And even more generally, we have that the successive minima is equal to the minimum for all phases of delta of dimension of f equal to I. Remember that we are in the case of an Ampelian bundle, so we are not losing information about the geometry on the toric, of the max for all x inside the phase of the value of this function on the phase. So the root function tells you all successive minima in this case. So toric varieties are very, very easy. I mean, even the simplest non-toric case, we have no idea how to compute things. By contrast, in the toric case, everything is very easy to compute. And for instance, we can prove Zhang's theorem in the toric case. It's almost trivial. So I will do the case just of dimension 1, because it is the one that I can make the picture in the blackboard, but you will see that this generalizes perfectly to arbitrary dimension. So imagine that I have my polytop here, then I have my root function, then this root function will attain a maximum here, and this is the maximum. According to this theorem, this is the value of the essential minimum, and it attains a minimum. Since the function is concave, the minimum will be always attained at a vertexes of the variety. In this case, this is the absolute minimum. Okay, and now I can look at this tent here. So tent that goes to the absolute minimum here and the absolute minimum here also. Okay, and now it's clear from this picture that the integral along delta of theta of x, it is smaller or equal than mu s times the volume of delta, and is bigger or equal in this case of this is not the product, this is the plus, so the product equals with the product. And in this case, this is bigger or equal than 1/2 of mu absolute minimum plus essential minimum multiplied by the volume of delta. Because I am looking at the volume below this function, that by concavity is below my function. This is this quantity. This is the quantity, the volume inside this function, and this quantity is the volume below this one, and we have this quantity. And now I apply that we know about the height and so on. So if I now so this is the volume is 1 over n factorial the degree of x times 1 over n plus 1 mu 0 up to mu n. So just so you can generalize this picture to higher dimensions. This is smaller or equal than 1 over n plus 1 factorial the height of x, and this is smaller or equal than 1 over n factorial the degree of x and the essential minimum. And from this, just dividing by the degree of x, that is bigger than 0, because the line bounded sample, we get this inequality here. Okay, so you see that toric varieties are too easy. I mean, almost all difficulties magically disappear and one can compute everything. And as you see, the root function tells you exactly the value of all invariants.
But for this notion of minima to make sense, do you need the line bounded to be toric?
No. For the minima to exist, what I need is the line bounded to be ample. Because then I have that the height is bounded below, and also I have this Northcote property that fixing the degree and the height, things are bounded. This I don't really need, but I need the height to be
to have a bound, a lower bound. And for this, I need the Lyman-Del to be ample. For instance, if I take minus L, then the height can be arbitrarily negative, and then I will not have a result like this. The absolute minimum or the infimum will be minus infinity, and then there is no result. Yes. So this theorem is always a metallized bundle such that the metric is semi-positive and the Lyman bundle is ample. Then you have this inequality. Okay? And then what I'm saying is that there is a proof here in the, and this proof is quite deep, so it's quite a difficult proof. But what I'm saying is that in the toric case the proof is almost obvious. Once you have all the computations. Okay. Questions? Okay, now we will use the techniques I have described to tackle another problem and to give a context of the problem I want to tackle. Let's ask a question. So if I look at the, I take a random polynomial and I look at a random polynomial, for instance, with integral coefficients. And I look at the complex roots of this random polynomial. And let's say that I start taking polynomials of degree bigger and bigger and bigger. Can I say something about the roots? I mean, this will be random points, or they will have some structure. What do you think? So what I am taking is a random polynomial of degree 5, now a random polynomial of degree 25, then a random polynomial of degree 100. Well, first, the question is, what is a random polynomial? Because a polynomial, the coefficients are infinite. If I don't describe the distribution, then I am not saying nothing. So just to fix ideas, let's say that I take integral polynomials where the coefficients are random between minus 5 and 5. Or I can take polynomials with random coefficients following a normal distribution, so I can get arbitrary high values. Or you are spoiling my thing. This is why professors are not allowed to tell, because then, okay. Well, he is saying that they will go to the unit circle. Let's make an experiment. I mean, sometimes one has to make an experiment, but now let's see if there is the, okay. Let's say, in order to be... What? Okay. So, I mean, I am taking constant coefficients between minus 1 and 5 just for simplicity, but as I said, you can use a normal distribution between minus infinity. Almost every... So if you want something that does not satisfy what he says, is quite difficult, so you really have to work hard. So this is a small program that chooses random values between minus 5 and 5 and constructs a polynomial with these values, computes the roots, and shows the roots here in this thing. So for instance, this is a random polynomial of degree 3. So I get 3 points, and of course I get some structure, because since my polynomial is integral, I know that if I have a root, the complex conjugate will be a root, so at least there is a symmetry. Now, let's take a polynomial of degree 14, and then I can get, I don't know, this looks like a spice ship. Again, the symmetry, but this can be random polynomial for anything, random points for anything I can tell. Let's go to 26. Now they start looking not at random, so it still looks like a spaceship, but now you can see that they look like something more or less circular. And let's go to degree 65. Now you can see the shape, and even following Duco's advice, let's take the picture of the unit circle. In red is the unit circle. And you can see that really all the roots, almost all the roots, are around the unit circle. There is always some roots that are scattered. But here I am in a polynomial of degree 66, and I have four roots that are far from the unit circle. The rest of the roots are very close to the unit circle. But not only they are close to the unit circle, but they are almost evenly distributed on the unit circle. So if you look at a small piece of some degree here, you will get, I don't know, five roots. If you look at the same space here, you will get maybe six roots. But more or less, they are evenly distributed. Okay? So this is an example of a phenomenon called, called equidistribution, which means that so it's a very nice way to study limits. So when you are adding particles and particles and particles and you want to understand what is going on, instead of looking at all the points, you can try to make some kind of average of all the points. And in this case, what we see is that this average converges to the unit circle, but not just the unit circle, but the not dense, the uniform, the hard measure of the unit circle. Okay. So this is equidistribution, and then what I want now to discuss is a little bit about equidistribution.
So this is the Riemann hypothesis for P1.
Yes? Is this true? No, no. No, this is an easy result.
Well, you are saying that if I take a polynomial of big degree,
yes,
the probability to find a root near the...
No, so the probability to find a root of unity is zero. What I am saying is that, and in fact I am also being not completely honest, because I want to do arithmetic, so I am taking polynomials with integral coefficients, and I want to use an argument using polynomials with integral coefficients. But in fact, this picture can be explained by the Erdos-Turan theorem and has nothing to do about arithmetic. I mean, it's true for any polynomial of complex degrees, as long as you take bounded, the coefficients are bounded, and you take the degree higher and higher and higher, you will see this picture. So what I am saying is that if you take a polynomial, let's say with bounded coefficients, or that coefficients that do not go very far away, and you take a polynomial of very big degree, the picture will always be like this. We'll have all the roots very close to the unit circle and evenly distributed. Okay?
So you can make an estimation, precise estimation, how close they are when...
So what you can make is an estimate. So this is, in some sense, not just that this point converges to the unit circle, but you can have an estimate of the difference between the measure given, the average measure about these points, and the average measure on the circle, and then you can get a quite precise estimate of this in terms of the degree and so on. Okay, which will tell you that you have these convergence. Okay, so in some sense I want to talk about equidistribution, and this was just for warming up. But then, if I take now a random matrix, a random n by n matrix, and I look at the roots of the characteristic polynomial of this matrix, any idea of what we will see?
Same.
No? Later, at the end of the talk, I will make the experiment. So who tells says the same? We have one person. Any other? Maybe, Duco, you have any guess of what can be, or you prefer not to say anything? No, this is just for fun, so this will not be part of the lecture. But we'll, at the end, we'll make experiments with other things, and we'll see the, what we get. Okay, so let me give a theorem that in some sense explains what we have seen. So as I have said, the theorem of Erdos-Turan already explains what we have seen, but I will give an arithmetic theorem that also explains a little bit what we have seen. Okay. So this is Bilou's equidistribution theorem. Mm-hmm. Okay. So now I consider a sequence pk, k bigger equal than 0, a sequence of algebraic points. Let's see, pk belongs to p1 of q bar. Mm-hmm. So I have a family of points in p1 of q bar. And I will assume the sequence, two things. The first thing is that it is generic. And generic means simply that it moves. So that the number of k's, such that pk is equal to a fixed value, this is finite. I don't want the same point to be repeated an infinite number of times. And the second condition is that it is small. And small means that if I take the height of these points and I look at the limit when k goes to infinity of this height, is the minimal possible value, which in this case is zero. But remember that is exactly the essential minimum, so the minimal possible value of a limit of heights of generic points. Okay? So I assume that I have this. Then I can look at the Galois orbit of each of these pk's. And this is a set. Let's say that this set is gk. And I denote by delta gk, the Dirac lecta on gk. This will be the probability measure on gk. So this is 1 divided by the number of elements in gk and the sum for all eta in gk of the Dirac delta on eta. So this is a measure, and one can apply these two functions. So this means that delta gk applied to a continuous function on p1 of c, for instance, is equal to 1 divided over gk of the sum for eta in gk of f of eta. So this is just I am giving the definition of this. I am just unwinding this definition. This is a measure on P1C, on the analytic space P1C. Okay? And I can also consider the measure delta S1 is the measure that at a function f, this gives the integral between 0 and 1 of f of e 2 pi I t d of t. Okay, so this is the uniform integral along the unit circle. Okay? I am going to measures because, in principle, how I can say that a shape converges to another shape? So the shapes are not in a metric space, are not in a space with a topology. But I can take a bunch of points and define this measure, which in some sense tells me what is the distribution of these points. I can take the unit circle, take this measure that in some sense tells me something which is evenly distributed along the circle. And now I am in measures, and in measures I have a topology, so I can tell about convergence and so on. So then the theorem tells me that these sequences, delta gk, converge weakly star or weakly to delta S1. Okay? This means just that for every function continuous on P1 of C, if I look at the 1 over the number of elements in gk of the sum of f of eta for eta inside gk, this is equal to the integral between 0 and 1 of f of e 2 pi I t d of t. For any continuous function, this limit is equal to this quantity, which in some sense is telling me that these points converge to the unit circle, because I can use these points to evaluate the integral along the circle, like I can do with the roots of unity. Okay, is clear? And now I use Jensen formula. That tells me that remember that when I was constructing the height of an algebraic point, this was defined as 1 over d, this is the degree, then log of ad in absolute value, then plus the sum for all eta inside g of xi of log plus of absolute value of eta. But now this can be seen using just a version of Stokes' theorem, Green theorem, or just a formula, that this is equal to 1 over d, the integral between 0 and 1 of log of p, so log of the norm of p evaluated at e to pi I t d of t. So it's just the integral of log of the value of the polynomial at the unit circle and then divided by d. Okay, now I am taking a random polynomial of very big degree with bounded coefficients. Then we can imagine that there is irreducible. If it is not, one can adjust a little bit the argument, but assume that it is irreducible, and then I look at the height of one of the roots. Since the polynomial has bounded coefficients, this quantity at most grows as the log of the degree, because I have at most d plus 1 coefficients, the coefficients are bounded. If I am getting the degree bigger and bigger and bigger, this at most grows like the logarithm of the degree. But I am dividing by the degree. Hence, as I am taking the degree bigger and bigger and bigger, I am getting a smaller and smaller height, so I can apply Villus' theorem, and the shape has to converge to the unit circle according to Villus' theorem. Is this clear? And also, this tells me something. What do I need to do if I want to go out of the unit circle? What do I need to do?
It seems that you have to change the coefficient instead of the degree.
Yeah. So in some sense, what I need is my coefficient should grow exponentially with the degree. Because then when I take the logarithm, it will be linear on the degree, and I will divide with the degree. Okay? Now think, if I take a square matrix, n by n square matrix, then, and it's random, the coefficients of the characteristic polynomial grow exponentially, because there are all these factorials appear inside. Hence, if I take a random matrix, I don't expect to get the unit circle, because in this case, I will not be able to apply this, because this will grow linearly with the degree, I will divide by the degree, hence, there is no reason why this has to converge to the unit circle. Okay, and then at the end, we'll make the experiment. So it's clear now the Villus' theorem. But this Villus' theorem is for, I have written it for P1, but in some sense this works for toric varieties and canonical metric. Canonical metric. So this theorem can be extended to any toric variety using the canonical metric by Villus. Mm-hmm. But this theorem, in some sense, is very, very general. And there is a version, a very general version of this theorem due to many people. So, now it's not blue. So, theorem. This theorem is due to Yuan in 2008 in the case of number fields. Yes, and by Gubler a little bit later in the case of function fields. I don't remember the exactly year, but it has contributions of many, many people. So, let me try to write some of them. So, Espiro, Ulmo, and Sang. They proved this for abelian varieties in order to prove Bogomolov conjecture. And then, after this, it was analyzed by Villus to toric varieties. By Chamberloir. So, these are equidistribution on the complex number on the Archimedean place. Chamberloir extended it to non-Archimedean places, and also Rivera de Tellier and Fabre. And Baker and Rumeli also have a version of this equidistribution theorem, and maybe more people that I have not. Okay, what is this theorem tells us? So I am in the same setting as the beginning of the talk. So I have X over K, where K was a global field. I am assuming that this guy is projective. Projective, dimension n. I have L bar equal to L and this matrix. A semi-positive. Semi-positive quasi-algebraic line bundle, metrics line bundle with L ample. Okay, so I have this setting. Now notoric at all, so is any arbitrary projective variety with L a semi-positive quasi-algebraic metrics line bundle with L ample. Then assume that I have a sequence that pk k bigger or equal than 0 is a sequence pk inside x of k bar. So it's a sequence of algebraic points such that, and then satisfies more or less the same conditions as in Biluth's theorem. The first condition is being generic. And generic means that for every y inside x subvariety, and let's say that x is irreducible, then for every proper subvariety, the number of k's such that pk belongs to y of k bar, this is finite. So I don't want my points to accumulate in a subvariety. So I want them to move around. And the second condition is to be very small. So in some sense, these people, they only say small, but I want to add the condition of being very small. So the very to their definition. And is that the limit when k goes to infinity of the height of pk is equal to the height of x divided by, with respect to L bar, divided by n plus 1, and the degree with respect to L of x. So that the limit of height is this value. Then I can look at delta g of pk, as before, is the probability measure that gives me the average on the Galois orbits of pk. This converges. Oh, sorry. Then for all b inside mk, so for all places, not just the complex numbers, but all places, I can construct this measure on the analytic space, either the Berkovich space or the complex space. This converges to delta of, no, this converges to weakly to 1 divided by the degree with respect to L of x of c1 of L with the Beadic norm here to the power d. Remember that this was the Monge-Ampere measure that we can associate to any semi-positive metrics of the line mantle. So we have this convergence, this equidistribution theorem for arbitrary points on arbitrary varieties. So it's a very, very general statement. Questions? So what is the small problem? So this theorem looks very, very general. And it's very strong because it's telling you that my points, so this distribution distribute to something, and they also tells me the limit in terms of the line bundle L. But this theorem looks very general, but it has a Haydn hypothesis, which is very, very strong. Can you see what is the Haydn hypothesis? So observe that I am taking a generic sequence. A generic sequence is a sequence that moves, that is not concentrated in a subvariety. And now I am looking at the limit of the height. What is the minimal possible value that such limit can attain? The essential minimum, because I am taking generic points. And by some theorem, I know that the essential minimum is always bigger or equal than this quantity. So in general, this theorem will be empty. Because in general, the essential minimum is bigger than this quantity, so there is no small generic sequence. So the problem is that for most of the metrics, this theorem is empty, because I will never find a very small sequence. So the problem, or the hidden hypothesis. For this theorem to be meaningful, we need that the height of x divided by n plus 1 and the degree of x is equal to the essential minimum. And in general, we know that there is only inequality. So we will say that L bar is, this is a definition, L bar is quasi-canonical. If and only if we have the equality, mu s is equal to the height of x divided by n plus 1 and the degree of x. Okay? And there are many examples of quasi-canonical metrics. So, for instance, in abelian varieties, the canonical height in abelian varieties comes from a quasi-canonical line bundle. In toric varieties, the canonical height comes from a canonical metric. If we have a dynamical system, normally we can look at a metric that is invariant under the canonical system by starting with any metric and taking the limit. This tends also to be quasi-canonical. But for instance, I don't know, so if I have a curve of genus bigger than bigger or equal than 2, I'm not sure if there exists any quasi-canonical metric. Okay, and we see that we need this to be very small. Now the point is that, okay, toric varieties are very easy. If we restrict to toric varieties, can we improve a little bit this result? So this is what we want to do, to study the case of toric varieties, to see if this is the best possible result or one can improve a little bit. Yes, so the nomenclature is small, but the point is that I prefer to call them very small because the limit has to be even smaller than small. So I will say that a sequence is small if the limit is the essential minimum, because it's the minimal possible value you can take. But if I want to get something even smaller, then I prefer to change the terminology. Yes. Okay, so now let's go to the case of toric varieties. Okay, when the metric is quasi-canonical. Any idea? So, when a toric metric will be quasi-canonical. Remember that the essential minimum was the maximal value. The height was given by the integral. The only way that we have equality is if the root function is constant. So the only possibility, so the metric is quasi-canonical if and only if the root function is equal to constant. Which up to scale is the same as saying that the metric is the canonical one. So this very general theorem in the case of toric varieties can only be applied to the canonical metric. It's the only metric that satisfies this hypothesis. But there are many other metrics. For instance, the Fubini's 2D metric on on the projective space is a toric metric. And we cannot apply Yuan's theorem, you cannot apply the theorem to know whether there is equidistribution or not.
Okay. Questions?
So then, as I'm saying, in the case of toric varieties, we have a theorem that again is the root function that tells you whether we can expect so equidistribution or not. So the point is that small points, even if we start with a line bundle that is ample and semi-positive and so on, it is not true in general that the equidistribution exists. But we have an if and only if, so a precise characterization of when we have equidistribution. So theorem, this is with Philippon, a sombra, Rivera de Tellier and myself. So let me write down the hypothesis. Okay, so we have the standard thing about global field, toric variety, and so we are assuming that x
and L bar as before, but toric. So is X is projective of dimension n, L is ample, L bar is semi-positive,
and so.
Now, since we are in the toric case, we have this polytop, and we have the global Rolle function, and let X, M be a point in the polytop such that theta of Xm is equal to the maximum for all the points in the polytop of theta of X. So I choose a point in the polytop where the maximum is attained. Okay? Then,
more hypotheses? No.
Then the following are equivalent. First, 0, the value 0 is a vertex of the sub-differential of theta at the point xm. Okay? So let me explain this. Remember that we have explained what is the sub-differential of a concave function at a point. It's just the set of all possible slopes that are above my function. For instance, if my function is C infinity, it is just the tangent value. Now, since this point, the maximum is attained, I know that zero is in this subdifferential. Because since the maximum is attained at this point, if I take the horizontal hyperplane, it will be above my function, hence zero is here. It's a set. One can see that this set is always a convex set, and zero is inside. Then the condition one is that zero is not just inside the set, but it's a vertex of the set. So it's a face of this set. Okay? And then the second condition. For instance, if this function is differentiable and strictly concave, then the subdifferential, no, just differentiable. If it is differentiable, then the subdifferential contains only one point. And this point has to be zero, and then zero will be a vertex of this set. So the conclusion will be true for any metric such that the Rolle function is differentiable. And then the second condition is that for every place B inside MK, and there exists a measure mu B, a probability measure, in X and B, in the analytic space X associated to B, such that for every PK, K, a sequence of algebraic points, remember that the algebraic points can be embedded in the analytic space for every B, for every sequence that is small, so that is generic, and small. Here I am not writing very small, I am writing just small because I am only asking that the limit of the height is the essential minimum, which is the minimal value I can obtain. So small means that the limit of 8 of pk is equal to the essential minimum. Then, so for every sequence, let me continue here. Then delta of g of pk, so the Galois orbit of these points, will converge to this measure mu b. So in order to have equidistribution, the condition is that zero is a vertex of the superdifferential on this maximal point. So if zero is a vertex, then I have equidistribution for all places. And if it is not a... And in fact, one can prove that one has either equidistribution at all places or at none. So this can also be proved. Mu, so there exists a family of values, u, b, for b inside mk. The u, b are elements in nr. The sum of all UVs is equal to zero, and UV is equal to 0 for almost all b's, except a finite number of them. And this measure, mu b, is just the hard measure on val minus 1b of this uv. So it's a hard measure on a circle, but it can be moved around. And this circle, so the point is that these uv's have to belong to the subdifferential of the local root function of xm. So this is the local root function, and this quantity is unique. So imposing this quantity automatically makes this unique, and it is characterized. Okay, so we have an if and only if, and we can obtain the measure. But in some sense, Juan's theorem, or this very general theorem, comes back with so it's really the best possible theorem in the result, the observation, is that this measure mu b is equal to 1 over the degree of L, C1 of L, and this metric to the d. So remember that in this very general theorem, there is a distribution, and that the limit measure is this here. Then this is equal to this if and only if the total root function is constant. So only in the quasi-canonical case. So really, if one wants that the limit is given by this Monge-Ampere measure, one really needs that the metric is quasi-canonical. So this Hayden hypothesis is necessary. If one only needs equidistribution and don't care which is the limit, so if you don't care what is the limit measure, or that the limit measure has something to do with L, then this is the only hypothesis one needs. Questions?
So the hypothesis is that the high is bounded by the essential.
Here, no, no. So here is instead of looking at every, so I look at every sequence that is generic. That means that it is not concentrated in a superarity, and such that the limit of the height is the essential minimum, which is the minimal value. So the point is that this theorem can be applied, in principle, to any toric variety because these sequences always exist.
So the consequence is that this metric given by the average of the orbits.
So what I'm saying is that in this case, if I take a sequence whose height converges to zero, I know that there will be a limit, there will be a structure in the limit, and I know what is this structure. So I know what is this limit.
Which was the probability measure you started with?
Well, no, what I am saying is that there exists a probability measure, and here I am characterizing this probability measure. So here I am telling you that if this is true, the probability measure is exactly this one. Okay? Okay, let's see some examples. Is there any question? Yep.
UV is zero almost everywhere.
Yes. So then the evaluation is exactly the unit circle. So because the evaluation of one is zero.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So then the evaluation. So this means that this measure for almost all places will be just the unit circle. One has to be careful because in the Berkowitz spaces, the hard measure of the unit circle is just Dirac delta at a point. So it's very counterintuitive, but this is because the Berkowitz spaces, if you have an analytic group, is not a group. So it's a group object in the category of analytic spaces. And then something which is supposed to be uniformly distributed is just a point in the middle. So, but in any case, it's the hard measure of the circle. Okay, let me give some examples. And then almost finish. So the first one is the canonical metric. Here we know that the norm of a section, so all the examples will be in P1 and with O of 1. And let's say that I am K will be Q.
to fix the idea. So I am in the simplest of the cases. I am in this situation. So the polytop, I know that will be just the interval 0, 1. Then, and the psi, the function is the minimum within 0 and u, the function that characterizes the Allen-Mandel. Then the canonical metric is the norm of S B is equal to the absolute value of S divided by the maximum between the absolute value of x0 and the absolute value of x1, and the for all B, and the function phi B that describes the metric is just equal to psi, is equal to this minimum of u and 0 for all B. So the root function is equal to 0, hence the global root function, which is the sum, will be 0. Now the height of x is the integral of this function on the polytop, is 0. The essential minimum is just the maximal value of this function, is 0. So in particular, it satisfies the condition of canonicity. I can take any point. At any point, the maximum is attained. For instance, I can take xm equal to 1/2. So the subdifferential of theta at xm is just the set 0. And of course, 0 is a vertex of 0. Now, in this case, I can apply Yuan's theorem. I can apply this theorem. And we deduce that the limit measure is just the Haar measure on S1. Now, let's go to the next example. A very easy one. Two is Fubini's 2D metric. The Fubini's 2D metric, in this case, we'll have that phi b is again the same thing. So the minimum between u and 0 for all b non-Archimedean, but for Archimedean, in the Archimedean case, this will be minus 1/2 of the logarithm of 1 minus e to minus 2u. So this can be computed easily. And you can see that this is a smooth function, that if u is very big and positive, then e to minus something big and positive, this is close to 0, so this is close to 1, so log of 1 is close to 0, so we are in this range. And if u is negative, but very big in absolute value, so then this will be a very big quantity. Oh, sorry, plus. So this will be a very big quantity. I can neglect the 1, so I will get log of e to minus 2u, so I will get 2u, multiplied by minus 1/2 is u. So I am in this setting. So this is some kind of a smooth approximation of my original function. Okay. In this case, we can see that the local root function will be equal to 0 for all b different from infinity, and theta b will be equal to minus 1/2, I think, of x log x plus 1 minus x log 1 minus x. This can also easily be computed. So we can compute the height. The height of x will be 2 times the integral of this function. So this is exactly the same as the global root function. And this gives me, I think, the height is 1/2. But the essential minimum, this function is symmetric under changing x by 1 minus x. So the maximum is attained at the point 1/2. And if I look at the point 1/2, what I get is exactly equal to log of 2 divided by 2. So this will be the essential minimum. So it's not quasi-canonical. But the subdifferential of the root function at the point 1/2 is the set 0. So 0 is a vertex of the set, and we know that there is a key distribution. So we conclude that if Pn is a small sequence, more generic sequence. For Fubini's 2D, then the limit, so delta of g of pk, will converge to, again, delta of S1. And this, in some sense, was not covered by the previous theorem. And now, finally, let me give a last example. Yes? And all non-Archimedean places, for all places, Archimedean and non-Archimedean. So I have that this limit is true in any analytic space, P1 analytic. Either it is Archimedean or non-Archimedean. We'll always have this. And then the third example is the twisted Bell metric. In this case, I will take the function phi b will be equal to, again, the minimum between u and 0 for b different from 2. And I will take the minimum between, I think it's u minus log of 2 and 0, if b is equal to 2. So this corresponds, I have done it correctly. Yeah. So this corresponds to the norm of S to be equal to the canonical for b different from 2, and is the absolute value of S divided by the max between the absolute value of x0 and 2 times the absolute value of x1. You can think that this is just a pathological choice, but it's not that strange, because this metric comes from the following geometric situation. I start in P2, and I consider the map from P1 to P2 that sends the point x0, x1 to the point x0, then 1/2 of x1, then x1. So instead of looking at the orbit of the point 1, 1, 1, I look at the orbit of the point 1, 1, half, 1. And then I restrict the canonical metric to this orbit, and then I get exactly this metric. So this kind of metrics can appear when one looks at translated of toric varieties. So a toric variety, but instead of looking at the toric variety going through the point 1, 1, 1, that will be some kind of canonical choice, one just translated by that point, that will change us this metric. Okay, so I have this example. Now, the local root function is equal to 0 for all b different from 2, but the function, let me take this picture. So, in this case, so one function is just this one, but this function will be just u minus log 2, so I need u to be there. Yeah, so the other will be exactly this function, just is the same function, just translated by log 2. And then translating translates on the, so can be seen, translate to the Legendre dual. So what we will have is that the root function at the place 2 is just a linear function that has value 0 here and has value at 1, has the value log of 2. Mm-hmm. So it's very easy to compute this thing. So we are in the piecewise linear case. So this is easy to compute. Now the maximum, so we know that it is not quasi-canonical, so we cannot apply Yuan's theorem, but we also know that, we can now can look at xm, the point xm will be equal to 1, and I can look at the subdifferential of this root function at the point 1. So these are all the slopes that are above my function. But you can see that I can take any slope, so in this point I can put, starting for slope 1, I can make it flatter, 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 up to slope 0, but even I can make any slope, any negative slope, and it will always be bigger than my function. So this is the set
minus infinity log of 2. Yes, because the slope here is log of 2. And clearly, 0 is an element of the set, but it's not a vertex, it's in the interior. So we know by our theorem that here there is no equidistribution.
Okay, on one cannot expect a good solution. In fact, even for the, so I have all the places are the canonical, even the Archimedean one, and I am only changing the place 2. Then one can prove that, for instance, over the complex, I have the unit circle, I have the circle of radius 2, I can take any compact subset inside this setting, big enough. By big enough, I need that the capacity is bigger or equal than 1. And then I can get a sequence of small points that converts to a measure supported on this set. So really, there is no equidistribution. One can make examples showing that there is no equidistribution, and just due to this small thing here that produces the fact that 0 is not a vertex here. Let me try to convince you that this is the case with an experiment. So here I am taking again the random polynomial, but this time I am dividing the term of degree I by 2 to the power I, because I am in some sense trying to reproduce the fact that I am looking at the small points of this new metric. This is why I have to add the fact that I have divided by 2i the coefficient of degree I.
Then I can evaluate this. Okay. And now I can take a. So I am taking this, but the degree of x, so I'm not dividing the coefficient by I, but I am taking x to the power I plus j, and I am dividing by 2 to the power I. Remember that this inclusion of p1 inside p2 was sending x0, x1 to x0, x1, and 1 half of x1. Okay? Then I am taking now a random polynomial into variables, dividing by 2 to the power I the variable y, and then replacing the two variables for the same one. So I am just taking a random polynomial in two variables and restricting to my function. This is why I get a lot of points. And you can see the result. So points in between these two circles. And if I take the unit circle and the circle of radius 2, I will get this thing. So the point is that if we just work with random polynomials, in some sense, it is there is equidistribution. So it will equidistribute to a uniform measure on this circle and a uniform measure on this other circle. But the point is that just asking that the points are small is not enough to get equidistribution. So I can construct sequence of small points that converge to anything. So I can make them converge to something inside here. Mm-hmm. Questions?
So you could modify this easily in two places or in
class. Yes, you can modify. In fact, what you can say is, okay, let's start with Pn, with the canonical metric, and now take any point of Pn, take any torus of a smaller dimension, and take the orbit of this point under this torus. And then this will be of this shape. And since it will be piecewise linear, almost surely there will be no equidistribution, because the maximum will be attained at a point where there is a corner, and then unless this corner is slanted, so there will be no equidistribution, because zero will not be in the set. But If we are taking the canonical metric everywhere and we are putting a smooth metric at infinity, then always the roof function will be smooth. And if the roof function is smooth, we'll get just one point, and then we will have a distribution. So in some sense, the two things, the piecewise linear, the model metrics, behave on a completely different way than the smooth ones. So with the smooth ones, we will always get a distribution. With the piecewise linear ones, we'll almost never get a distribution, unless we look for them in a very precise way. Mm-hmm. Questions? Well, and then just for fun, let's see the one about the matrices. So now we know that for matrices, there will be no equidistribution in the unit circle. Anybody wants to guess what kind of distribution are we going to get? So if I take a random n by n matrix, I look at the roots of the characteristic polynomial, and I take the degree very, very big. What kind of distribution do you think we will get? So let's go. So you see it's, well, maybe it's not big enough, but instead of being in a circle, they are in the unit disk, but they are evenly distributed inside the unit disk. So we get the uniform distribution on the unit disk. So let me picture the unit disk. And even higher degree. So you will see that all the points are more or less evenly distributed. So they are not random points. So if you take a picture of random points, they will be more clustered. So random are not as uniform as one might think. But this is really tends to the equidistribution on the unit circle. Or, for instance, if one looks at n by n matrices times the inverse of another matrix, then one can get the uniform distribution on the whole projective line. So there are many, many phenomena of equidistribution. Yes, this one for fun. Okay. Yep.
Can you make the degree higher?
Even higher than 34? Well, if we have time. Let me change a little bit, so the slide, so what degree do you want?
70.
Eh?
70.
Yeah, 70, I mean between 60 and 70, there will be not that different.
200.
200? 100, let's say 100. So I will change this to 100. Yeah, well, it's he who should be doing in 5 minutes. Okay. It's just a 100 by 100. It should not be that difficult to get the eigenvalues, I hope. Yeah. Oh, yes. Here we see something. This is why I stopped at 60. Because after many experiments, I don't know if you have seen this message at the beginning that using, so yeah, I hidden it. So when I make this program run, he was telling me, caution, use a generic algorithm to compute the eigenvalues of a matrix can give you errors, numerical errors. Now I am taking my 100 by 100 matrix, and you see that this comes exactly by rounding errors in the construction of the polynomial. And the 60 was more or less the limit of the capacity. So I can ask him to use numbers of higher precision.
Yes.
But this, I can do it, but not now, sorry. Sorry. I will have to Google how to do it. Sorry. Yeah. Of the error, yes, it's very curious that the error is just making exactly one hole in the middle. It's a very strange behavior of this error.
We don't understand.
No? I don't know. Yes. Point is that here is error, and normally error can lead to difficult questions to know it. But this is an interesting thing. This is why I stopped at 60, because 60 I was sure that the errors will not kill everything. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But this doesn't follow the circle law, right?
No. The point is that, as we have seen in 60, for instance, let's do 60 that we know that more or less is
Okay? Or 71 maybe, let's see, if we are lucky. Yeah, so what we get is not the circle, but the unit disk.
Right.
And it's uniform on the unit disk. And this is a theorem that is proven. I mean, it's proven that the random matrices, the eigenvalues of the random matrices, follow the uniform distribution on the unit disk.
It's a theorem by Wu,
right? Yes, yes.
Is something known about how fast it is?
Yes, they are studies. Yes, they are studies. So in some sense, they are able to give bounds on the difference between the uniform distribution and this distribution. So the point is that now here you have to start with a continuous function. The problem is that continuous function may have a lot of slope. Then what you do is, okay, I take the uniform distribution applied to my continuous function, and this distribution applied to my continuous function, and the difference can be bounded by the Lefschetz constant of the continuous function. So the point is that if the function has a lot of slope and some points is, has a very high Lipschitz constant, then the difference is very big, but it is bounded by the Lipschitz constant of the function f. Mm-hmm. And then there is a theorem that tells you that there is a bound, and hence there is a convergence. So it's really, even the speed of convergence is known.
More questions?
No. Okay. So now, since I am the last speaker, maybe it's a good moment now to thank the organizers for this organizing this beautiful event, school, and in particular to invite us to this beautiful place. So, thank you.